Hello and welcome. My name is John Dickinson, and in this two-part walkthrough tutorial, I'm going to show you how I created this look for the Predator sequel Prey using After Effects and Boris Effects Continuum. So go ahead, download the project file, and let's jump in. Okay, so if you have the project open in front of you, go ahead and twirl open the comp folder and double-click main. Now, I have a proxy enabled. You can see a little box here next to the comp icon and also this message down here. You won't have that, so just disregard that. I've just done it so that I can get some quick RAM previews. I'm actually going to toggle that off just for now. And let's come right down to the bottom to text treatment, double click. When I was looking at the original trailer, and if you've seen it, you'll know that the text looks pretty much like this. It's kind of a stone look. And it's on a black background, so it's pretty simple. And as a first step for creating my look, I wanted to replicate that look as close as possible. So the first thing I did was I went into Illustrator and I just traced the Prey text just using the Illustrator pen tool, and I saved that as an EPS. And that's because if we just select the Prey layer, I've used BCC Extruded EPS to create this extruded look. So let's just turn off hue, saturation and rock. And just twirl this open and take a look. Okay, so with BCC Extruded EPS, first thing to do is load an external file by clicking load and choosing Prey05.eps. You'll have that file in your download, so you can go ahead and open that in Illustrator and take a look. Once that was loaded, you could choose an extrusion style. There's a number of different extrusion styles to choose from. Mine's set to default gray. I actually came in and I adjusted the extrusion depth. Let's just increase that. With the trailer, the extrusion is quite shallow, so I need to keep that pretty shallow. Bevel style is set to straight, and bevel amount is set to 11. We increase that, you can see we'll get a much thicker bevel. Now, for material, you can see I've got material count same on all sides. You could put different materials on the front, back, bevel, and side. It wasn't necessary for this. For the material, I chose stone sea green marble. And if we click on that, you can see there's a huge list of materials to choose from. I just cycled through those until I found something that was, you know, fairly plain, but matched the trailer as closely as possible. Now, also under material, you'll see there's a bump setting. If we click on the arrow, there's the same list of materials. Now, you could use an identical material for the front texture file and the front bump file, so the bump would match the texture. But I decided to use a different material just to add some variation. I chose stone distressed plaster. You might like to go ahead and try some different ones. So once all that was set up, then I adjusted the lighting. And you can see I've used built-in lights 1, 2, and 3. And the best way to look at how these are affecting the text is to view them one by one. What I might do first, though, is just come down and activate hue and saturation. Just to make this grayscale. So let's turn these all off. And we see black because there's no light. So if we turn on built-in light one, you can see that built-in light one is up here above the text, and that doesn't give us any illumination on the bevels. For that, we're using lights two and three. Built-in light two is all the way over here on the left, and you can see this is giving us some good side lighting. And built-in light 3 is giving us some top lighting. So when you are lighting using BCC Extruded EPS, as you should do when you're doing any 3D lighting, is do one light at a time. That's much easier than working with multiple lights at the same time. Just go ahead and turn these back on. So that's the base look. One thing to keep in mind is that inside Illustrator, I had to exaggerate the space between the points for these, cracks. Because once I applied the effect, these closed up quite dramatically. So I just had to push them a little bit further out than the image I was tracing, just to compensate for that. Okay, so I could have left it like that, but I wanted to take it a little bit further. And to do that, I've actually used BCC Rock. BCC Rock is adding a lot of variation. Let me just turn these layers off. And we'll turn that on and off again. Just adding some nice grayscale variation. And while BCC Rock can be used to create some basic rock styles, it's best with this effect to use a surface image. And you can see here for the image layer, I've chosen tarmac.jpg. That's this layer here. Let's just turn that on. So this is an actual photograph of a tarmac rather than computer-generated rock, which gives us a more realistic surface. Let's just turn that on and off again. So it's increasing the contrast and adding a little bit more variation. Now, I did notice on the prey graphics that the bottom of the text was a little darker, and I did try to create that sort of lighting effect inside of Extruded EPS, but I was unsuccessful. So instead, I've just used a black solid, I've just named it Veil, and I've masked it and placed it over the top. And you can see I've used the soft light blend mode. Just like that. Okay, now notice when I turn these transform adjustment layers on that the text was scaled. I'm just going to turn the top one off. Now this first transform layer is using BCC plus transform and it's scaling the text up. Notice how gang is selected. So that means we can change the scale X value and it's going to change the Y value as well. And I could have made these layers 3D and used a camera and just done a little camera push on the Z. But using the transform effect on an adjustment layer like this is just a quick way to create that fake 3D move and affect all of the layers below without having to make everything 3D. And it's also really good when you've got situations where effects have been applied to the layers and they're slipping because they're moving in 3D. And that is also out of interest, if we did make this prey layer 3D, because it has the BCC Extruded EPS effect applied, we will get a warning message just telling us that effects that use cameras or lights should be applied to 2D layers. So just something to keep in mind. Now there's another transform effect above that, and this is the first part of the prey animation where the text is small. This is in the cloak composition, and we'll take a look at that in a moment. Okay, so that's the text treatment. Let's go back to the main comp, and we'll double-click this cloak composition. Let's start at the bottom. At the bottom, we have a stock image comp. So let's double-click that. And in here, I've used a file from Unsplash by Luis Etienne Foy. So this is a free image. Now, you'll need to go ahead and visit Unsplash using the link in the description, download this image, and replace the image that's here. Okay, so let's just solo the bottom layer first. And notice how this is a 3D layer, and I also have a camera. If we hit U, we can see the camera keyframes. So I've keyframed the Z position of the camera just to dolly out just slightly. Now, to add some depth to that, I've duplicated the image, and I've masked off the trees. And if we just go to top view, just select all of these layers, notice how our background image is here, and I've just move these two foreground trees on the Z-axis just to pull them into the foreground, just to add a bit of space between them and increase the parallax when the camera pulls back. So it is pretty rough. I did apply a couple of effects just to make it look a little more reasonable. You can see here I've used fast lens blur and roughen edges because I had to scale this layer up quite dramatically and it did go quite soft. But because it's in the foreground, using something like BCC Fast Lens Blur just gives a nice natural lens blur and makes it look slightly out of focus. So that hides that low resolution. And obviously masking around the edges gives us a very smooth line. But a little trick is to use something like Roughen Edges just to break that up. Let's just take a look at the alpha channel by alt-clicking on the Show Channel button. And you can see by using Roughen Edges, it's just broken that up. I've used the Rusty option. And if I increase the border, you can see it eats further in to that image, which actually looks a little better, doesn't it? Now you can see through to the trees behind. So rather than going in with the pen tool and just making a custom path, which would take forever, this gives a nice organic roughness to the edges. I like that better than my original. Let's also increase the one on the other side. Yeah, much better. So it's fairly rough, but I think just adding these elements into the foreground with this camera move just makes it look a little more like footage rather than panning and zooming a still image. Okay, so let's hit the tab key And we'll just use the left arrow key and we'll go back to the cloak composition and hit the space bar just to open that up. Now you may notice that we've got a little bit of displacement on this stock image, and that's being caused by BCC Displacement Map. If you've seen Predator, you'll know that the Predator uses a cloaking device. So I wanted to try and, you know, do a dodgy version of a cloaking device. And when the Predator moves in front of, you know, the foliage in the jungle, it kind of displaces the background. So you know that the Predator's there. Obviously, if it was completely invisible as a viewer, you wouldn't know where the Predator was. So we had to see some kind of, you know, displacement of the background in order to know where the Predator was. So it was difficult to see, but not impossible. So for BCC Displacement Map, I've just, as a map, chosen the text treatment layer. And I've used a little bit of pre-blur. Let me just bring this down to zero. See how there's a lot more finer detail when pre-blur is at zero? But by increasing that, we get more of a smeariness, which I liked. Made it look a bit more glassy. On top of that, we have the text treatment layer. And I've done a couple of things to this. I've used the Add Blend mode, and I've applied BCC Edge Lighting. And if I hit the T key, you can see opacity is set to 15. So if we bring that back up and turn that off, there's the prey text. I'm going to undo that. And I applied BCC Edge Lighting just to give it a little bit of movement, because obviously when the Predator's, you know, moving through the trees in the jungle, it's very dynamic and you can see the Predator displacing the foliage as it's, you know, moving around. But this text is static, so I wanted to add some kind of light displacement to give it some kind of interest. So I chose BCC Edge Lighting and I've animated the light direction. And remember, the text is scaling up because we used the transform adjustment layer in the previous comp. And I have to say, I didn't spend hours and hours working on this look. I just wanted to do something that made it feel like this was supposed to be the Predator cloaking device. So that's the background and the text image. I did feel that there wasn't enough movement in this shot. So what I decided to do was add a little bit of fog. Let's just turn this one on first. And notice how above the double fog layer, this is using BCC plus double fog. We've got turbulent noise, and this is using the default After Effects turbulent noise effect. So let's come and just turn off the Luma mat and take a look at double fog on the background. You can see how that's really overpowering. I do like the continuum fog effects. You have fog and double fog. I felt that fog wasn't quite enough. That's why I used double fog. But I also wanted to break the fog up a little bit and add a little bit of movement. And that's why I've used turbulent noise. So let's just isolate that one and just do a little preview. You can see the turbulent noise is shifting from left to right and it is evolving slightly. For the evolution, if we just hit E twice, that'll show us the parameters that have expressions applied. I've just used a simple time expression times 50. So that's giving us a little bit of evolution, giving it a kind of a smoky feel. And for the movement, I've just used the offset turbulence under transform and just animated it from left to right. So if we just hit U, you can see a couple of keyframes. So it gives it this kind of gently drifting smoke feel. And using that as a luma mat for the fog makes a double fog a lot more subtle and adds some movement. It is very subtle, and I did want to add a little bit more down by the creek bed. So what I ended up doing was duplicating that setup and just adding a little bit of extra down here by the creek bed. You can see how I've masked off the turbulent noise for that. And you may be wondering, John, why didn't you just use turbulent noise and not use double fog? And I'll show you. Let me just come in and turn off the luma mat. Turn on turbulent noise. And change that to add. You can see how that makes that super bright. The reason I didn't do it was because I wasn't getting the look that I wanted. And I did like the look of double fog, but it was just too intense. Okay, so I'm going to undo that. And the last layer in this composition is BCC Film Stocks. So I've used BCC Film Stocks just to do a quick grade. And if we just open up the FX editor, you can see there's a huge range of presets here. And as usual, I just like to go in and browse through the presets and choose one that looks good. Don't spend a lot of time on color grading at all. We just search for corpse. The one I've used is Corpse Bride. And you can see if I apply that here, it actually removes the vignette. So what I did was use Corpse Bright as a base and then just come down to the settings and then just turn on the vignette. That also helps with these trees as well. Just moves them into slight darkness and focuses the attention on the center of the frame. And there's the finished look for that shot. Yes, I know it's quick and dirty, but I think it did the trick. So let's leave that there, and please join me in part two, where we'll explore the thermal vision treatment along with the various transitions, the heads-up display, and also the video glitch effects. Hopefully you found that useful. If you're not using Continuum, you can download a demo at boriseffects.com, where you can also find a range of tutorials to learn how you can include Continuum into your workflow. For now, this is John Dickinson. Have fun, be creative, and I'll see you in another tutorial.